Hi class, so far we have learned how to solve quadratic equations using factoring. Quadratic equations, if you'll remember, are in the form of ax squared plus bx plus c, and we always want to get zero on one side before we factor. We're going to find a new way to solve these today, which is called a quadratic formula. This formula here can be found by taking this equation and doing a process called completing the square. Completing the square is a process that we'll learn in a future class. However, we're going to use the formula that you get from completing the square on this equation in order to solve problems that might not be factorable. If you can factor a quadratic, factoring may end up being an easier way to solve the problem. However, if it's not factorable, factoring is not going to work for you, and you're going to need another tool. That other tool is this formula here. You'll notice that this formula has A, B's, and C's in it. Those A, B's, and C's are the values that you get from the A, B, and C in this equation. The A will always be the coefficient in front of x squared, B will always be the coefficient in front of x, and C is always the constant on the end. You want to read the A, B, and C off of the equation when you already have zero on one side of that equation, as you see right here. Now, you also, in this formula, want to make sure that you follow order of operations. And order of operations has you start with parentheses. This radical here acts as a parentheses. It's grouping this stuff right here underneath it. So we want to always start our calculations underneath here by first doing our exponent by squaring the b, and then multiplying the 4 times the a times the c, and then we'll combine those and see what we get underneath the square root. So that's kind of where we're going to start when we do our formulas. Now let's take a look at a problem that's not factorable that you would need to use this formula for. Our first problem we're going to deal with is 3x squared plus 2x minus 3 equals 0. Notice we already have 0 on one side, so we can read what the A, B, and C are straight off of the equation. If we didn't have 0 on one side, we would make it so that we had it by just using our basic properties of algebra for solving equations. Reading off of this equation, the A is the 3, which is the coefficient of this x squared, B is 2, which is the coefficient of x, and C is negative 3, which is our constant on the end. Notice that the signs in front of those values went with those values. So if your B was had a minus in front of it, we would have a negative 2. This one has a plus in front of it, so we have a positive 2. So always make sure you take the signs with it, just like I did on the C value here. It was minus 3, so the C was a negative 3. Once you have those values, you just take and replace the A, B, and C in our quadratic formula here with the values that you read off of your equation. And a strategy for solving these and trying to remember what this formula is every time you do a problem, I would copy this formula down, and then I would write down what the values are, as I did here, and then plug them in. If you keep writing down this formula every time you use it, you'll tend to remember it better and know when to use it when you're doing your problems. So let's go ahead and plug our values in, and x is going to end up being the opposite of b, because notice in our formula we have negative b, that means the opposite of b. Notice when I plug the value of b in that I put parentheses around it. If you put parentheses around each of the values when you plug them in, you'll tend to have fewer errors when you're doing your calculations. So I'm going to replace this b under the square root with 2 also, and that's going to end up being squared later. Minus 4 times the a is going to get replaced with a 3, and the c is going to get replaced with a negative 3. In the denominator, we have 2 times our a value, which is 3. Now that we've plugged everything in, all we need to do is go ahead and calculate. We're going to start underneath our square root. And so I'm going to first, this opposite of 2 is going to end up being actually a negative 2. And then underneath our square root, starting with our exponent, 2 squared is 4. And then multiplying, if we have negative 4, because this minus goes with the 4, times 3, we're going to get negative 12. And negative 12 times this negative 3 here ends up being positive 36. In the denominator, we have a 2 times 3, which is 6. And now we need to combine our 4 and our 36, and that's going to leave us with a square root of 40. Now, you do need to make sure that you simplify your square roots when you're doing these problems. If you're dealing with a story problem, it might make sense to go ahead and use a decimal approximation, but if you're not doing a story problem, you don't want to use a decimal approximation unless you're asked for it. In most cases, you'll want to simplify. And if I go ahead and take a look at this square root of 40 here, I need to search for the largest perfect square that divides evenly into 40, and that would be 4. So we're going to break this square root of 40 up into square root of 4 times square root of 10. And square root of 4 is 2, so this is going to end up being 2 square root of 10. So we're going to have negative 2 plus or minus 2 square root of 10 all over 6. Now, we need to reduce this if we can. The way you're going to reduce this expression is you first need to see if there's anything in common in the numerator. And I notice that 2 goes into 2, and there's also a 2 in front of our square root of 10. So that means that I can factor a 2 out. That's going to leave me with negative 1 plus or minus the square root of 10. And once you've factored that out, you can actually reduce it with the denominator. You can't reduce it until you do that. So 2 goes into 2 once, and it goes into the 6 3 times. So the reduced value we have here for x is going to be negative 1 plus or minus square root of 10 all over 3. Now, when you write your answer, which I'm going to go ahead and do up here, you're going to need to recognize that the plus or minus actually gives you 2 answers. We have a negative 1 plus square root of 10 all over 3, or x could also be negative 1 minus square root of 10 all over 3. So we can write this as a solution set with those 2 values. Now, that's an example where we did just a basic equation. Oftentimes, you end up with story problems that can be benefited by using the quadratic formula to solve them. So, let's take a look at one that you might have to deal with. You might be given a story problem where you're given a formula for the height of an object as it's tossed through the air. The reason why you're going to do that is because in the next video that you take a look at, we're going to be graphing quadratics, and graphing quadratics is going to always give you a shape called a parabola, where if you toss an object through the air, notice it's going to make this shape, the shape that this happy face is making. That's called a parabola. All of these quadratics make that shape with their when you graph them. Now, your parabolas can either be this way or they could be this way. Obviously, if you're tossing an object through the air, it's not going to make this shape, it's going to make this shape. And we're going to see why in the next video that that's the case. There's actually a certain number in your formula that makes that happen. So let's take a look at a situation where we're told that the formula h of t equals negative 16 t squared plus 5t plus 20 models the height of some object that's being tossed through the air t seconds after it is released. So if you plug in 1 for t, you'll find out the height after 1 second. If you plug in 2, you'll find out the height after 2 seconds, and so on. So you need to keep in mind that this h of t over here, that's not really h times t. That's the function h, which is the height of the object, with a value plugged in for t. So what we're going to do in this one is we're going to say that this formula here is the modeling the height of the object t seconds after it's released, and that height is going to be in feet. And let's say that you're asked to find when this object is going to hit the ground. Well, when it hits the ground, the height above the ground is 0 feet. So that means we can replace this h of t with 0 and solve our equation to find out what the time is going to be for when it does hit the ground. Now, this particular equation here is not factorable, so we're going to need to use our quadratic formula. So the first thing we need to do is figure out what our a, b, and c are. And the a is this negative 16, the b is 5, and the c is 20. So now we need to plug those into our quadratic formula right up here. So in this spot here and here, we're going to replace the b, which we said was a 5. Here and here, we're going to replace the a, which we said was a negative 16. And right here, we're going to replace with 20, which is what we said our c was. Now, when we replace the values here with these values here, it's going to make more sense for us to have a decimal approximation for our final answer if the square root is not a perfect square. So we are actually going to, rather than simplifying our square root, get a decimal from our calculator. Now, when we get our final answers, one of them will be positive, one will be negative. It doesn't make sense to have negative time, so the positive time is going to be the one that's actually our solution. Let's go ahead and plug our values into our quadratic formula. That gives us, now instead of x, which is something you guys will need to watch for because a lot of times people will use x because we're so used to it, instead of x we're actually searching for t. So you can replace the x value here with a t because t is the variable in our formula. And so we're going to have the opposite of our b, which is 5, plus or minus the square root of the 5 squared, since b is 5, minus 4 times our a value, which is negative 16, times our c value, which is 20. This whole thing is over 2 times our a value, which is negative 16. Now we need to simplify this. So we're going to start underneath our square root, and underneath our square root, the 5 squared is going to turn into 25. And then we're going to multiply our values over here, and in a calculator, if you do negative 4 times negative 16 times 20, you're going to get 1280. So that changes this particular value into negative 5 plus or minus the square root of 25 plus 1280 all over negative 32. Now, if you add 25 and 1280, you're going to come up with 1305. So we have negative 5 plus or minus square root of 1305. Now, 1305 is not a perfect square, so we're going to get a decimal approximation for it. And if you do the square root of 1305 in your calculator, you're going to get approximately 36.12. So that's the value we're going to use for that. Now, we're going to need to use the 36.12 and separate this particular expression here into two expressions and calculate them out. So we're going to actually go ahead and go up here and separate it into two problems. We're going to have negative 5 plus 36.12 over negative 32. And this is approximately that. We're also going to do approximately negative 5 minus 36.12. over negative 32. This first value here ends up being negative, so this is not the one that we're going to use. The second one down here ends up being positive, and it is a positive 1.285. So this second one is the one we're going to use, and we would say that the object is going to hit the ground in approximately 1.285 seconds. And that's how you would use the quadratic formula in some kind of an application problem.